So even though 2018 managed to disappoint me in ways I didn't even think were possible when the year started, it also happened to be the best movie year of the goddamn decade. Seriously, just an amazing year for films. Films I was really looking forward to lived up to the hype. I saw movies that I heard were really good that I just decided to blind watch and they actually turned out to be great. And movies I thought would suck actually turned out not to. And I didn't even see that many bad or mediocre movies. I mean, sure, there were some disappointments like Pacific Rim Uprising and Red Sparrow, and I don't care what anyone says, you were boring! But there were so little movies I saw that were bad or mediocre that I only have one dishonorable mention. Yes, this movie did not get on the list. Oh, it was still bad. The two leads had no chemistry, it was dumb, and still pretty damn boring. But unlike the last two, stuff actually happened in this movie. It wasn't very good stuff, but at least I felt like there was an actual plot. And unlike the last film, this actually had some atmosphere, and the soundtrack was better. So congrats, 50 Shades. You ended with your best film, and still no one cared. But let's not waste any more time. We're counting down. Suicide if you ever try to let go. The top 5 worst movies of 2018. Number 5.
Blumhouse continued their winning streak that they started last year with movies like Upgrade, Unfriended Dark Web, The First Purge, Black Klansman, and Halloween, all ranging from pretty good to fantastic. So it's a shame that the one movie they released that they decided to put their name in front of was fucking terrible.
I brought you all up here to play this game because I'm okay with strangers dying if it means I get to live.
I really do like the concept of this. Yeah, it's a horror film based off a party game, and a lot of people had problems with that premise. But Happy Death Day also had a weird premise, and that movie was great. But Happy Death Day had a comedic side to it, while Truth or Dare is so damn serious. Oh, it tries to have comedy. None of it is funny, because the characters suck, and we'll get to that in a minute. But for the most part, it's so overdramatic. With a dead dad, a gay character trying to come out to his homophobic father, and pedophilia. There are glimpses of potential, like a scene on top of a roof, and the climax had its moments. However, like last year's number 5 worst movie, Wish Upon, this is also a huge ripoff of Final Destination. Why are we getting so many Final Destination wannabes? The last one was 7 years ago. But yeah, like Final Destination, it's a supernatural force that is coming after you, and you either have to outsmart it, or it will kill you. However, unlike Final Destination, where the deaths were wonderfully over the top and fun, Truth or Dare's deaths are all just lame. And if you refuse to do the dare or tell the truth, the demon just takes over your body so there's no suspense. The acting is hit and miss, but the only character I liked was the main one, Olivia. Everyone else is either a complete douchebag or so fucking sensitive when it comes to these stupid truths.
I get hearing some of these would be really hard, but given the circumstances, I think I could look past it and move on.
No, these characters don't do that. They just get offended and fight or run away. But despite all of that, for most of the movie, I didn't think it was that bad. Just sort of dumb and mediocre, might have been saved from the list. But then the ending happened. This has one of the worst endings I have seen, not just this year, but of the past several years. It's the kind of ending to where even if I love the movie up to that point, I would still never watch this movie again. So if you want to find out what happens, you can either watch it for yourself, or wait till October when I review this, because it is that terrible. Number 4.
I put a poll on Twitter about a month ago asking which movie I should watch in order to knock 50 Shades off the list. That poll included Death of a Nation and The Darkest Minds. But instead, my followers pick this.
I want to make it clear. I think a Slenderman movie could be great. I don't care that he hasn't been relevant in 3 years. If this movie were good, it could have maybe reignited an interest in him. But no, this movie is ungodly bad. boring. First off, it's repetitive. The entire second act is basically the same thing happening over and over again. Our bland, uninteresting leads see something that later turns out to be a vision. Sure, the locations change. Once it's in a library, another is when one of them is having sex. There will also probably be some distortion effects because that's what all ghost demons and anything else supernatural does now. But what makes it more boring than that is the way it's shot, paced, and acted.
Before I watched this, I thought there would be many words to describe it. Dumb, lame, annoying. But one word I was not expecting to use was pretentious.
I'll give the director and cinematographer credit. They had a vision. I mean, the vision was clearly inspired by It from 2017, but they at least were trying to make something visually interesting. And overall, they did. The look of the film is probably the best thing about it. But it's also a monkey wrench that prevents the movie from being any fun. It's paced and acted like some experimental art house movie. You know, the ones that only the film snobs like. But it's a movie about Slender Man, so the film snobs already aren't going to like it. Making it so artsy like this just sucks out any of the enjoyment you could get from a silly, campy thrill fest. Look back at It. Yeah, it looked amazing, but it was really just an over-the-top thrill ride, and it gave us characters that were really likable. I don't remember a single name from this movie, let alone a personality trait. Every one of them is completely forgettable. I at least remember how dumb and douchey the characters in Truth or Dare were. The only thing I remember is that one of them was stupid enough to remove their blindfold when they were specifically told not to. And because it's paced so weird, it feels longer than it actually is, and because it's structured so weird, I couldn't tell how much longer the movie had left. In fact, at one point, I thought we were just entering the third act, checked the time, and saw there was only 10 minutes left. Slender Man isn't scary, and there's tons of fake-out jump scares.
Why didn't they just make this a found footage movie? Oh right, they couldn't, because if they did, then everyone would just be comparing it to Marble Hornets, so instead they just decided to make something that even the most pompous film student would scoff at. Just one step ago.
I'm sad, I know ya. I'm sad, I know ya. Number 3.
Looks like you were disqualified for lack of depth perception.
What?
You don't have depth perception. You can't be a PJ without it.
Are you serious?
Choose 3 jobs from the list in order of preference.
This movie is holy shit bad, which shouldn't happen for a movie directed by a guy who has won Oscars. For those who have never heard of this, it's based on the 2015 France train attack, where a gunman tried to shoot up the train, but was stopped by 3 Americans, so thankfully no one died. The main gimmick is that it actually stars the 3 Americans who stopped that attack. And before we move on, despite how bad this movie is, I am not blaming these 3 at all. What they did was very brave, very heroic, and they deserve all the praise they got. And despite one of the big worries being that they are not actors, they actually aren't that bad. They have a few dud line reads, but they clearly are good friends and have good chemistry. And it doesn't hurt that most of the rest of the cast, who are actual actors, are worse. It is actually surprising how terribly acted and made this movie is. And the editing is awful. It keeps cutting back to the terrorists preparing for the attack, because it turns out making a movie based on an event that only lasted a few minutes probably wasn't the best idea. Other movies based on real-life terror attacks like United 93, Patriot's Day, or July 22nd, the event either lasted long enough to fill out an entire movie, or the aftermath did.
What does this movie spend half its running time showing us? The 3 guys vacationing in Europe.
Now you're probably thinking, oh, you're just exaggerating. No, there's about a 40-minute section of this film that is just the 3 sightseeing through Europe. Drinking, getting snacks, dancing, meeting hot foreign girls. That's it. I'll give it this though, it did make me want to visit Europe. It did look like a lot of fun. It was boring to watch, but I'm glad they had a good time, I guess. The rest of the movie is mostly focusing on the one guy, Spencer Stone, and if I'm to believe this movie, he is a really shitty soldier. He arrives late, he doesn't follow orders, and he's just really bad at everything he's told to do. And again, I'm not saying anything bad about him, the movie is. The other 2 I honestly don't know much about. I know Sadler likes selfies. The only part that actually excited me was the final fight on the train, which made me think, why didn't they make this a docudrama? Have interviews with them and the other survivors, and splice them in with reenactments.
I hope they do make that movie at some point, because quite frankly, these guys deserve better.
I'm sad, I know ya. I'm sad, I know ya. Number 2.
What happened to you, Raja Gosnell? You made Scooby-Doo 2.
Hey, wait, what's he doing back there?
The pain passes, but the beauty, she remains.
Wait, what?
This one was not picked by my Twitter followers. I decided to watch this purely on my own free will because I have nothing better to do with my time. Show Dogs is fucking awful. The voice acting is bad. All of them either sound dull or annoying. I will give credit that the live action actors are okay and the dogs themselves seem pretty well trained, but even then they have these weird CGI touch-ups at random points. The CGI is horrendous. I don't care if this costs $5 million. If you don't have the money to make the special effects not look horrifying, then just come up with a way to not have to put special effects in.
And I swear that baby panda still haunts my nightmares.
The directing is terrible, the movie can't have any genuine moments because it feels manufactured, and when they do try to have a sweet moment, it always adds in some stupid jokes. Oh god, the jokes. It's mostly bad puns, toilet humor, and pop culture references. I chuckled once. But you know, I expected all that. This movie is also shockingly poorly written. Normal bad kid movies are just generic, an excuse to tell lame jokes. And yeah, this is generic, but the plot doesn't make sense. One, it feels both rushed and slow at the same time. We have the third act breakup in the second act, and like three different climaxes. And character motivations sometimes don't make sense, and they will often forget things. Like at one point, Felipe the trainer dog is angry at the main character Max for cheating in one of the events. But the thing is, Felipe knows that Max has to win in order to get taken by the bad guys so they can track them down. So they have their little fight, and it seems Felipe doesn't want to help Max anymore. But then in the very next scene, he goes with them to catch the bad guys. The cheating thing in their fight is never brought up again. This movie feels like it should have been released in like 2005, and it still would have been one of the worst movies of that year. And for a children's film, as in a movie made solely to be watched by kids to keep them distracted, there are a surprising amount of adult jokes. If this movie is only meant to be viewed by people 10 and under, by that I mean no one else is supposed to be watching it, then why are those jokes in there? Don't have my mild swearing, sexual innuendos, jokes about being inbred, and oh yeah, ball touching.
Yeah, I didn't see that version, but between that and the scene where Max is almost forced to have sex with another dog, it gets a little uncomfortable.
I'm sad, I know ya. I'm sad, I know ya. Number one.
Let's do some time traveling, yo!
To the time cycles!
I'm kidding. It's Winchester.
Henry! Henry! Oh, please! Please come back to me!
Now, some of you may be thinking, really? This is your worst movie of the year? And yeah, it's not really noteworthy, just a crappy horror movie that came out at the beginning of the year. Compared to the other two horror movies on the list, you'd think this wouldn't be very infuriating. But I really fucking hated this film. It is so goddamn boring. Every scare is a jump scare. The characters aren't interesting, I remember nothing about them, the acting isn't that good, and it has absolutely no atmosphere. I spent the whole movie thinking, this is just some actors walking around a set. I am in no way invested. It's very repetitive, and it follows the shitty horror movie formula. You know the one, where for the first two acts of the movie, nothing happens, it's just a bunch of characters talking, and once in a while, a very small supernatural thing will occur, and then in the last act, it goes batshit crazy to the point where it's stupid. You have to build up. You can't just bore us for an hour and then in the last 30 minutes decide you're going to do something. No, motherfuckers, you had your chance. But what really pisses me off is that it doesn't take advantage of the location. It's set in the Winchester House, a house that you can easily get lost in with doors that lead to nowhere, and they barely did anything with it. This lands at number one because it's the one I remember the least about. At least the other four movies I can remember something about them. This has nothing but some nice cinematography. I hated this. It's the perfect example of a January horror movie. Too bad it was released in February.
So that's it. Join me tomorrow for the best of the year. Bye. I need a girl like-